I'm Bill Regas. Happy to be here with you today. I was named after my grandfather on my father's side. In Greece, they called Bill Vasilios. So I can be Vasilios, or most of the time I'm just Bill. My dad came to America when he was 14 years old. And he came over from Greece on a boat, and he was a little mischievous, as I understand, when he was 14. And his father asked him, said, "What would it take for you to be a good boy?" And he said, "Loan me enough money to go to the States." They called United States of America the States. And so Granddad loaned my dad the $100, and he came on the boat and of course came to New York, and he was working at odd jobs in restaurants to begin with, is what I understand. And he was a dishwasher and then a cook, and he finally worked his way up in the restaurant business. But he had one time he was laying tracks on the railroad when everything was moving west. And he had a variety of jobs. And my Uncle George got an opportunity after several years of working in the big cities to come to Knoxville. And he invited my dad to come and join him here, and they started a restaurant together in Knoxville. And it was just a real small restaurant, you know, about 8 tables and 8 booths and about 18 stool counter, I understand. David Thomas and I got to work at the Wendy's founder, and I got to work that same counter in 1942 to 1945, when World War II was going on, and most of the men were all fighting, and so there were no child labor laws then. So we were, I guess I was probably about 14 years old, and he was 12, and we developed a long friendship there. We had a lot of good memories there with two and three families, the Regas families that worked there. My cousins, Gus and Frank and Charlie, and all of us worked together. And we all learned to work at an early age. My dad thought it was good to learn the work ethic early. And so we were pleased that we had the good development from my dad. He was jovial and happy, and happy guy. But when he said something, he wanted you to do it. And you know, you knew right away when he was joking and when he wanted some action. He taught us always to do your very best at whatever you're doing. And I remember when he'd bring report cards home, he wouldn't say, "Well, you should have made an A, or you should have made this or that." He said, "Well, is this your very best?" And if you said yes, well, he was happy to sign it. But if you said you're not sure, well, he said, "Next time I want you to tell me it was your very, very best, expected best effort from the children," and then his team members that he worked with and gave job opportunities to, he expected the very best from them as well. My dad met my mom, I think he was about 38 or 40 years old, and she was Edith Rankin, and she grew up in Jefferson City, Tennessee. and she had a job as a cashier at a restaurant across the street from Regas, where my dad and uncle were running their restaurant. She was in the Busy Bee Cafe, and she was a cashier. And she was a beautiful lady, and dark hair and brown eyes, and my dad fell for her right away. But he couldn't get her attention right away. It took him a few times that I think he was turned down for dates, but he persisted and he won her over, and they were in love and had a good marriage, and he had three children, my sister Frankie, and I was in the middle, and then my brother George, and he was the most mischievous one of the three, and he ended up a preacher. And he was a good one, too. The personalities of my parents, my dad was kind of fiery and humorous and happy-lucky. My mother was a little quieter, as I recall. She died when I was 6 years old, and she was always gentle and kind, and I never saw her mad. But she could be firm too when she needed to be. But my dad was real proud of his family, and he'd get us all together to go have our pictures taken as a family a lot. And I don't think that his family were able to get pictures made way back in Greece, but he took every opportunity to get family pictures made, and he's proud of his family. He was very loving, and hugs and kisses, and sort of like Greeks and I guess Italians too, that they're used to expressing their love and their affection, and we got a lot of hugs, and some of the friends we grew up with, well, their parents were not that way, but we were always glad that our parents were affectionate and appreciative, and they knew how to inspire you to do your best. My father lived, to start with, on East Fifth Avenue out in Park City. Strange as it might seem, my Uncle George and his wife Penny lived on the second floor of that house for several years, and then they finally got enough money to buy another house shortly down the street. So they had a very humble beginning. We had two uncles that were my dad's brothers. That was George and Harry. And George was my dad's partner. We were close to him and Uncle Harry. Uncle Harry had a little restaurant down on West Cumberland, Regas Coffee Shop, and he was a good restaurateur too, and we were close to them. Then I had an uncle on my mother's side, Gene Rankin. Gene had a restaurant out on Central Avenue. He worked with my dad and uncle for many years as a waiter. And then he had his own restaurant out on North Central called Rankin's Restaurant. And they're famous for good breakfasts and biscuits and meatloaf and things like that. He does a good job. And he was very affectionate. We liked to play with him a lot. We were lucky when my mother died that we had good aunts and uncles, and they kind of filled in for my mom. My dad never remarried, and he was busy running the restaurant and looking after the family, and he was a very good dad. They had what we call the streetcars back in those days. They had the trolley lines, and the tokens were worth seven cents, and you put a token in and you could ride back toward Chilhowee Park, or you could ride town in the trolley. And I remember the trolley was on Magnolia Avenue, which was a street that ran parallel with Fifth Avenue. And so we'd go to the park sometimes, and then they had the fair every year, and we'd get to go to the fair. And I remembered my dad would give us a dollar to go to the fair, and rides were 10 cents a piece, or you could go to a show for 10 cents. So you had 10 different activities you could do with that dollar. Well, we could ride the trolley downtown, and at the Tennessee Theater, they had what they called the Popeye Club every Saturday morning. And we'd go there in the Popeye Club, and they had entertainment for kids and special shows and that type of thing. Then we'd go to the YMCA too some, and swim and play around the track and so forth. When we got out of school, we'd play outside when we'd have opportunity. And remember where Swan's Bakery used to be? It's two blocks toward town from the Park Theater, and the Park Junior. You know where Park Junior High School is now? That's where we used to play. Swan's was right near that. They had a big lawn there, and we'd play ball on that lawn, and so that was fun. We moved from Fifth Avenue to Linden Avenue about 1947. My brother and I went to TMI to high school. I was in the ninth grade, and my brother George was in the seventh grade. And the way we got to go to TMI was that we were going to Park Junior at that time, Park Junior High School. And we decided to lay out of school one day. And we were walking the railroad tracks, smoking Lucky Strike cigarettes. And that night when we got home, my dad called us in and he said, "Boys, I heard what you did today. One of my friends told me they saw you today and you weren't in school, and I'm going to send you to military school, Tennessee Military School in Sweetwater, and get you some discipline down there." So we had to go down there and go to school at TMI, and it helped us. We learned to obey and have good manners and learned to march and all of that, and it helped us so much that my three cousins, Gus, Frank, and Charlie, all had to go to TMI because we laid out of school one day. And so they're about to get over it, but one of them's still mad. My brother George went into the ministry. My dad wanted him to be in the restaurant business. And a fellow called to serve the Lord, and he was real close to Eugene Hopper, was the rector of the St. James Episcopal Church on North Broadway, and that's our church where we grew up. And sometimes my dad would take us and drop us off at church, and he'd go back to the restaurant and get lunch ready to serve many people after church gets out. And in that restaurant, we were open 7 days a week, 24 hours a day. And they really worked hard and long hours. My sister Frankie was in the business with us too. And she was a very important part of that business, as it was Kiki, my Uncle George's daughter, was involved. I've already mentioned Gus and Frank that were in the business, and Charlie. But we all, as kids, were involved in it. And my sister, when I got out of the Korean War, she joined me, and she and I took over when my father died. My father died in 1953. When my dad died, well, my Uncle George lived 5 more years, and we worked with him closely, and then he died in 1958. But my sister, Frankie, was in charge of the dining room, and I was overall general manager, and Gus and Frank came in a few years later, and Charlie worked with us a while too. So they were all good, hard-working guys, and we all had jobs that, and then we'd have a monthly meeting and talk about how we're gonna get better. We try to keep improving all the time. Taking over and being in charge of the whole restaurant at a young age, it was a challenge. Took me three years to find out what I was doing, but then I began to like it and try to get better at it. We moved from Fifth Avenue to Linden Avenue in 1947 or 48, and we lived there all through the time that we went to the University of Tennessee, and then I went to Korea in the war, and I guess we lived there probably 5 or 6, 7 years, something like that. And then I was married Elizabeth Frost, and she was a beautiful lady, by the way. That's what the Greeks are looking for, those pretty ladies. And she was from Elizabeth, Tennessee, and she went to East Tennessee State her first 2 years, and transferred to UT, and that's where I met her when she was, we were juniors at college. Yeah, I want to tell you about how I met her. She's a gorgeous woman, and I was attracted to her. Oh, the way I met her, though, was I was in the Kappa Sig fraternity, and she was a Chi Omega, and the Chi Omegas had a Sunday afternoon tea that we were supposed to go to because I was in Kappa Sig. And I reluctantly went to that tea, and that's where I met her. So I've been famous to going to teas ever since. She made better grades than I did most of the time at UT till the last year or the last quarter. Then I made a little better than she did. I just kidded her and told her she must be in love. She wasn't focusing on her studies. She was a good athlete. She was a great swimmer. She had a hole in one time when smoking was popular, and the golf society sent her an ashtray and had her name on it, hole in one. And where it was located, I forgot where it was. We were on vacation somewhere. She had a hole in one. Elizabeth and I were married in 1951 after we graduated from UT. And I was a second lieutenant through ROTC, and I signed up. You know, during that time, every man that was 18 years old, if you weren't in college, already in the service, well, you were lucky. But I got my commission, and I signed up for 2 years active duty and 5 years in the reserve. And we graduated in May, and we married in December. The honeymoon was real, real short because we got married and went to Fort Jackson. We stopped a couple of nights. The first night was Abington, Virginia, the Martha Washington Inn. That was the first night. And then Then we went to Winston-Salem the second night, and then it was, Fort Jackson's Columbia, South Carolina. That's where I was stationed. And so that's the third night back in the Army. But it was great. Sharon is the second daughter. Carol was the older one. So he's William Grady Regis. We call him by his middle name, Grady. And her husband's a cardiologist, John Acker. And then they have three sons and a daughter. And then they have three grandsons. And Sharon, she has two daughters and a son. And one daughter has two little girls, and one's 3 and a half and one's 2. And we've had a lot of fun. But Mom, it's a shame that Liz, my first wife, didn't get to see any of her grandchildren. But she sees them from up above. Roosevelt would say, "I hate war. My wife Eleanor hates war. My dog fella even hates war. But we gotta fight and protect our country." And he had the ability to rally the whole country. I remember that. David Thomas and I, when we were working together during World War II at Regis Restaurant. On the night shift, it came around 2 o'clock. We'd make a couple hundred sandwiches for the Oak Ridge workers that were building Oak Ridge, you know, the building the atomic bomb. And it was so secretive, nobody seemed to know exactly what they were doing. But the workers that were building it didn't have a place to eat, and they would come in and eat breakfast at Regis at 4 in the morning. Have a big breakfast and buy a couple of sandwiches and a piece of pie, and we'd put it in a paper bag and they'd carry it out to build Oak Ridge. Dave Thomas and I were best friends. We were servers at Regus, and on a busy night, we were on the night shift a lot of the time, from 8 at night to 6:30 in the morning. And if we could make $3.50 to $5 a night in tips, we thought we had a good day. So you can see how humble our beginning was. We worked together as teenagers and developed a life friendship. And then when he got real successful with Wendy's, he started to work his way up. That's a rags to riches story there. He started out in the Kentucky Fried Chicken business, and he worked. Colonel Sanders was one of his mentors, and then my father Frank and Uncle George were mentors for David. And after David got with Colonel Sanders, he took over two or three Kentucky Fried Chicken stores in Columbus, Ohio, that were not doing well when Colonel first started his carryout stores. And he turned those around, built a couple more, and sold those stores back to the parent company. And he was a multimillionaire at 30 years of age. And he'd come through Knoxville, and he said he's going to go and start a hamburger business. And at that time, you had hundreds of McDonald's and Burger Kings. And I remember my sister Frankie saying, "Well, David, how are you going to go in the hamburger business now? And all these big companies already got hundreds of stores out there." And he said, "I'm going to make a hamburger fresh off the grill and fix it any way they want it. And it won't be wrapped up and under a heat lamp. It'll be all out the grill." And he made it work. You know, it was single, double, triple, and French fries and Frosty. But my dad always coached him well. And Dad would tell him, "In America, you can do anything you want to do. You can be anything you want to be if you really try." And he remembered that, and he's quoted that over and over, and gave my dad and uncle credit for teaching him quality. You know, you see Wendy's old-fashioned hamburgers, quality is our recipe, and he gives my father and uncle credit for teaching him that. We were partners for 15 years and didn't have a crossword. So I think you'd say he was probably my very best friend. Everything was downtown, you know. The Christmas shoppers, you know, 2 weeks before Christmas, Gay Street was shoulder to shoulder with people shopping for Christmas, and Miller's, and there's George's, and Penny's, and all of those stores were within two or three blocks of Gay Street. And it was a bustling, and then in the 50s and 60s, it deteriorated, and in 1970, when the big Westtown Mall opened up, downtown really went down. But it's come back, you know, in the last 5 or 10 years, Knoxville's downtown has come back. 70, we evolved from sort of a coffee shop, diner type place, very, very casual. The food was always good, but it was very casual. And when I took it over, we had a decent lunch, but we didn't have much business at night. And that was 60s and 70s, and we had to spruce it up to get people to come back down and have dinner. And we worked hard at that, and I think we were successful. We had a little ad in the paper every Wednesday, you know, for an evening to remember, Regis. We'd have a little chandelier in that ad on the top corner, and that ad would say romance or warmth or fireplace or candlelight. And that was the type of atmosphere that we were developing to bring people in for dinner, to be romantic and celebrate birthdays and anniversaries, and for young couples to come and court, and older people to celebrate their golden anniversaries. We had a broad market, and I think we worked it pretty well for 30, 40 years. And then it got back to extreme casual again. And now, you know, fine dining is not dead, but it's not what it used to be. It used to be chocolate meringue pie and coconut meringue pie for many, many years. And then it switched over to what they call icebox pies, which icebox pies were chocolate, lemon, and coconut with whipped cream on them. But the standard was the apple pie, you know, just a great apple pie. And they were famous later on for red velvet cake. And we had a lady with us that was a great cake baker, and she was famous for her red velvet, German chocolate, and that type of thing. Bobby Wynn was the lady's name, and she was a night manager at Regis all during World War II. But she had this hobby of doing cakes, and she'd come and work maybe, she'd usually start about 8 o'clock on her shift and work around about 6:30 all night long. But early on her shift, she'd make three or four or five cakes. You know, she could make lemon cake, fancy icebox pies, and she'd make that red velvet cake. She was just famous for that. And a lot of people ask for the recipe, but it's a lot about how you blend it and how you mix it and the temperature of the oven, and all of that's got to be perfect to get it just the way that it's good and moist. And some cakes dry out too easily, and they leave them in the oven a little too long, or the oven's a little too hot or whatever. But she just had it perfect. And we got the same recipe, and we've been making it great all these years, but we just couldn't get it quite as good as she did, because she was the master at cakes. Just a fine lady too. She was with us many, many years. We did Grady's in 82, and we sold it in 89. We ran it 7 years. And that was some of our best years at Regis. But the economy was, and that's when Ronald Reagan took over in 80. And you remember, interest rates were 19%. Inflation was the same, 18 to 20%. And with an economy like that, you couldn't grow and expand. That was in the 78, 77, 70, in the late 70s. And then when we worked hard to get Ronald Reagan, actually a National Restaurant Association, supposed to be non-political, but we had a special group that worked hard for Ronald Reagan. And when he got elected, we got to go to the Oval Office to see him. And I'll never forget when I first met him, he was behind his desk and he jumped up and put his hand out he said, "I know you guys helped me get elected." He said, "It's going to be a tough job, but we can do it." But he made you feel like you could do anything, you know. That's the way he was. And then his leadership from 80 to 88 was good times. You had a little inflation. You had 7% interest rates. And he knew how to do it. First thing he did was cut taxes, and then he started cutting waste and paying the debt. My dad always believed in a strong restaurant association. Those first little pictures that you saw, you had a little NRA emblem on the window of the restaurant. He always believed in that. And he was the first president of the State Association of Tennessee State, and I was president very young, 27 years old, as president of the state. And then I got to represent Tennessee on the national board in the late 60s. And I learned a lot by, you know, being with the leaders in the industry. You get ideas of why they're successful. And David Thomas, he'd always say, you know, he just had an eighth grade education, but he'd say, I like to be around successful people and observe why they're successful. And so that's sort of the philosophy I was taught. And so I did that. And I worked my way up through the chairs, you know. The financial, then the vice president, and then the year that my first wife died, Elizabeth died, was 78. And so I was scheduled to go on as treasurer that year. And then I got with my partners and I said, "Well, can I do this or not? You're gone about 25 to 30% of the time, and you're going to different states to help, you know, whatever the issue of the day is." And we agreed that I should do it and try to learn all I can. And I did that in 1980. It helped a lot. I got ideas for Grady's. And then my son went with me some, and he got ideas, and we put it all together. And so I was elected in 1980. And that's when we got Ronald Reagan to replace Jimmy Carter. And our association wasn't only, but it was just about every profession saw that what Carter was doing couldn't work. And, you know, what we're into now is not going to let us create jobs. But it's different. You know, the problem then was high interest and inflation. Problem now is a weak economy and no job creation, where our young people getting out of college, now it's hard for them to find a job. So we got to all get excited, I think, about who's going to lead us. And I'm going to try to stay away from, saying a name. But there's somebody out there that's got Ronald Reagan qualities, I hope. Well, probably the best is when your grandchildren can say, "That's my poppy," and do it in a proud way. And poppy means dad, or means granddad, great granddad, and maybe great great granddad someday. So they can look at things that were important during my lifetime, and they can apply it to whatever the issues are in their lifetime, whenever that comes. That's the idea. Just pass it on, and then you give them education and opportunities, and you hope they use them well. It's good when you can break bread with family and friends and build on that relationship, and the city prospers, and this country hopefully will prosper, and leave opportunities for our children and for our grandchildren. The world marches on.